Thank you for the band today. Weren't they amazing? Scott, if you could just hold this right here, just hold it right like that, and keep it above my head. So it's a weightlifting. Okay, thank you. looks good, doesn't it? I'm wearing my zesty clothes today, especially the tie. So glad you're here. Today is one of the days that I love the most here at Bridge City, because the people we've invested in for so long get to share back with you their God walk. And the Bible says that, Jesus said actually, Bible too, but Jesus said it, unless you become like a little child, you cannot enter the kingdom of heaven. And ironically, we don't listen to children that much. So today is kind of a special day. If you came expecting to hear Mark speak, wait a little longer. It's going to be magnificent and beautiful and fantastic as Mark does. But today's that breath in between. And these guys have worked hard. They had an assignment from me. So being the ogre that I am, I love coming out of the picture. Like if you were in your house and you walked in the hallway and all of a sudden like your grandma goes, hi. Wouldn't that like just tweak you for the rest of the week? Like you wouldn't tell your friends or nothing because they'd think you were crazy. But ironically, we frame God, right? We put him in a frame. It's our culture, our experience. And today, these six students have been asked to frame God from their perspective. So it's about a heart journey. They're going to share some pictures I asked them to take via their teacher, Jonny Long, who's amazing. Pictures they took to kind of engage this. And then they're going to share from their heart. Everybody has about 2 or 3 minutes, and we'll wrap up at the end. Thank you so much for being on the journey with us in this. I love these kids. Well, all these kids. I love you too. I love you too. But this is their chance, and thank you for making them feel loved and cared for in this process. Jonny, it's all you.
All right. Well, we're going to get things started off with Mr. J.J. Penn, who is not with us today, but he's made a video for us. So we're going to go ahead and start with that.
Hi, my name is J.J. Now, I see that trouble and unity are kind of related, so I put them together. Now, troubles are everywhere. They're pretty much whatever annoys a person or makes it harder for someone else. Last year at my school, I had a trouble, a big problem. I would play fun games instead of doing my homework. Internet games, whatever, something to not do my homework. And that caused me to destroy days, and I wouldn't get my homework done. I kept on doing it over and over again. But finally, the drilling punishments finally found the goal. I just was tired of the constant punishments. I finally found my mistake and stopped it. This year, I have my homework, and I get my homework turned in on time, and all is well. There are some troubles that are so catastrophic that it brings people together, to work together, to take care of each other and protect each other. There are natural disasters like tornadoes and tsunamis and other things like hunger and clean water. Water, pure water, is something that we can't drink. Not everybody has it. Dirty water can make us sick, might not even taste well, can even kill people. As Jesus once was here on earth, a pure man who died for us, a clean rag that cleaned up the mess, clean water that cleaned out the cup and filled it up so we can drink. The Holy Spirit is here, working through people, through us and through other people. I believe that the Holy Spirit is bringing us the will of God, is telling us the will of God so that we can take it and follow it, so that we can, in these catastrophic events, we can go and support other people with what we have, and we can also spread the gospel to them. We can tell them that God died for them. Now, we're choosing to fulfill his will to take care of the suffering people. I mean, they don't have any hope. When a tsunami comes in and hits all their family away, and they're by themselves, they don't have any hope. They don't have anything. So we can take care of them. And by using the Holy Spirit to help us, we can give them hope. We can love them. I've always wished that the world could be free of sin, that there were no troubles. Everybody would be pure. If there's no troubles, then everybody would be awesome, amazing. Now, if everybody was pure, though, then it would literally be heaven on earth. I think that God doesn't prevent these natural natural disasters, because he knows that we can spread the gospel through this. And I always imagine in heaven, there's no natural disasters. There's no pain or suffering. There's joy and celebrating. And I believe that there won't be any troubles in heaven.
And these are some of JJ's pictures that he associated with his talk or video in this instance.
And heart. In losses, if you've lost a loved one, you can feel angry, sad, you can feel alone, almost like God was trying to hurt you. And for me, when I lose someone that I love, I feel angry and sad and confused, etc. But God helps me understand and work through what I'm feeling, and helps me feel better. And people can just sit and think with God for hours, just thinking and working through what they're feeling and untying the knots. I've done that before, just sitting in my room for long periods of time, just thinking what I'm feeling and just going through it. And grieving and crying does help. It says in Psalm 9:9, "The Lord is a refuge for the oppressed, a stronghold in times of trouble." Grieving brings healing to my heart. I see God working in hearts in many ways, and he wants you to open up your heart so you can let him into your heart and your life. Like, if your heart is hurting and you have let him in, he can just mend the pieces back together. I also see God working in heart relationships, like with my parents. If one of their hearts are hurting and they're grieving, I might just see them hugging on the couch or talking in their bedroom. It says in Psalm 147:3, "He heals the brokenhearted and binds up their wounds." I see God working in the brokenhearted in many ways, just like I see in everybody else.
Oh, let me check that for you. Oh, yeah, look at that. All right.
Hi, my name is Ellie, and I'm going to talk about emotions and community. I think that we can portray a lot with our emotions. I think of our emotions like painting a picture. For instance, there might be a big red picture with glass on it for anger, or black with splatters of paint. And I think that God will comfort you when you're sad, angry, or frustrated, or any emotion. I think that he will be there for you and understand what's going on in your mind. I think that getting out your emotions is really important, and I think that God helps you with that. And it's really not good when you hold them in, and I've struggled with that myself. I held my emotions in and didn't journal about it or tell anybody, and they just bursted out, and that wasn't fun. And I think you need people around you, like your community, to help you with that, even if it's your family, neighbors, friends, or your church community. I think that God will show your love to you through your community, and that you can show his love to others in your community by serving them or giving them someone to lean on, if they're believers or non-believers. In Mark 5:19, it says, "Tell them how much the Lord has done for you and how he has had mercy on you." I think that there will always be a situation in your community where you or somebody else needs someone to lean on. And I think that's why God made community, so that you can always have someone to talk to and always have someone to lean on.
That was awesome, Ellie. So the two areas that God affects my life in are my thoughts, and then my family. So, start with thoughts. So, God's my conscience. He's kind of the guy who says, is this a good idea at all? Should you really be doing this? I mean, is this what you should be doing at this moment, right now? So, he kind of keeps me on the right track. I also picture God to be kind of like, when I'm scared, my own personal army or like big bodyguard, like just a guy who can take on anybody. Like I'm scared, and so I kind of picture him just being right outside my door, just there 24/7 every day of the year, there to protect me so that I'll be able to live a long, happy life.
Safely.
This is my family now. I think God is kind of in the self-control department, you might say. Say I'm out in the garage, I've been working out, I'm about to leave, and then my mom comes in. She's been having a great day. You know, she's all dressed up in a robe, you know, all warm and chatty. But then here am I, and I'm not in the greatest mood for chatty, no. So my first thought is to kind of blow up at her, you know, like, leave me alone. And so then God comes in and says, pause, take a moment, collect yourself, and then answer her questions nicely, and then exit. But then if I do kind of blow at her, if I don't listen to God, then basically I'm going to be getting the same thing back. It's really going to be, it's like Matthew 7:12. In everything, therefore, treat people the same way you want them to treat you, for this is the law and the prophets. It's exactly like that. If I'm mad at her, same thing coming back at me. Okay, but now with my siblings, it's a little different sense, so we'll have our arguments, right? You know, then we'll walk away, pout. And so, in a way, God just kind of smooths out our little anger issues. Like, he makes it kind of end kind of fast, so that we can just continue on being our own happy selves. Like, he makes it so that we forget we are mad, and we just say we're sorry, we can just continue. We can just be done with it.
So I think most of you know this because I've been here a long time, but my name is Tienna. In these last like 2 months, I think, or 1.5 or something, I explored 2 different places that I think that God is a part of in this world, in our lives. And I think he takes part in our relationships and words, as in what we think or say. So I think that Jesus can help us connect or form bonds with other people instead of not being friends, and can even make your friendships or stronger with other people. And I think that he can help people, or at least me, not react too quickly or be angry at people and unkind, and can help me understand, or at least stop to understand, what someone else says instead of kind of yelling at them. So with some of my relationships, like with my brothers and sister, I think I could probably listen to them more instead of hurting their feelings, because I want to prove that I'm right and they're wrong. And I think that I want to be better at understanding what they're saying, so then I can at least know their point and we can accept it instead of just being grumpy at each other all day. And so I'm not very good at that, but I'm working on that part. And so with words, I think that Jesus can help us realize what we're saying and help us be kinder and more thoughtful with people. And so sometimes I think of stuff I used to say to like my brothers and sisters and friends, and I wasn't always the nicest person out there. And so sometimes I end up just thinking through how I could have said things better, and so I'm trying to change that. And so my goal is to be able to think through what I say to people and be able to represent myself in a good way and not come across as like mean, because I don't want to come across as mean, because that's not nice. And so I want to know how to make people understand what I'm trying to say and not come across wrong. And so I think that Jesus can help me and other people become kinder and more thoughtful.
So I'm Grant. A few people just
can't hear you.
Hello.
Oh, okay.
Booming voice. Okay, so I'm Grant. I had the privilege of capturing two really cool subjects on how, you know, God interacts in the world around me. These were with your spouse and in society, you know. So I really think that relationships are a pretty huge gift from God, and that we can benefit from them in really, really big ways. Specifically in my case, or in this case, relationships between a man and a woman, you know, romantic relationships. I mean, just picture a world without having connections or bonds with one another, or never having a romantic relationship with someone else. So in the beginning, when God created humans, he created man and woman, not just one or the other. I think he did this on purpose, so men and women are meant to have a relationship with one another, and you know, meant to have a connection because, well, it's fun and enjoyable, and so they're not alone either. I have a really great mother and father who demonstrate this connection very well for me. So relationships really are what make the world around us in our society. Society isn't anything physical, any of the structures or landscapes or buildings. I think it's actually the people who inhabit it. So, I don't know if you've ever taken a walk around Portland, but you know that there's definitely a pretty huge mixture of people here. You know, the hipsters and all that, and especially people who aren't as fortunate as us and maybe don't know Jesus. I think Mark 2:12 relates to this pretty well. It says, "On hearing this, Jesus said to them, 'It's not the healthy who need a doctor, but the sick.'" Everyone in this world is broken in some way or another. Nobody's completely pure. But a lot of the times, I think it's the people who don't know Jesus who really need him the most. So I think because of this, us as Christians really have to live as an example to those and show Christ's love through our actions and words, because we never really know who we'll affect by just being ourselves.
So, am I on? Yep. Yeah. So that was a great segue into what I'm going to share with you, which is my own personal relationship that I'm currently in. So Philippians 2:5 says, in your relationships with one another, have the same mindset as Christ Jesus. So 7 years ago, I stood in a hallway being loud and probably obnoxious, and one look was all that it took. Pink jacket, jeans, long scarf, beautiful, flowing dark hair. She was gorgeous. Still is, yes. And just so happened to be very young as well. So fast forward a few days, weeks, months, and years, and you'll see the same girl in the back that I was enamored with then, who is now my fiance, Melanie. I would have her stand, but I think it might embarrass her. So, so it definitely takes willpower and an incredible amount of intentionality to maintain and nourish a relationship in high school and throughout college, especially when a state separates the two of you. And in fact, if my memory serves me correct, Kevin suggested at the time that we not continue our relationship. And if there's one thing that I've taken away from this, it's that Kevin has in fact been wrong at least once in his life. So the first book that I ever read pertaining to relationships or marriage was In the Road Less Traveled by M. Scott Peck, and it's a phenomenal book. If you haven't read it, you should. In it, he says, true love is not a feeling by which we are overwhelmed. It is a committed, thoughtful decision. And I completely, wholeheartedly agree. And I think this is how God wants me to view my relationship with Melanie, my fiance. Too many times it feels like people base and connect their relational problems to a negative emotion or feeling or illogical rationalization. I fell out of love with you. You're terrific and nothing is wrong with you, but I have to follow my heart. I've found my soulmate. I don't pretend to know everything about love, marriage, and what it takes to have a completely successful, God-driven relationship. I think being in love and in a committed relationship is really hard at times. And with that said, it's also been the single most rewarding thing that I've yet to experience in life. It's phenomenal. And over the last 6 months since being engaged, I've had numerous people, friends, you know, joke, all in good nature. Well, just give it some time. Wait till the rose-colored glasses fall off, then you guys will find out. You'll find out, you know, what you really think of each other, and you'll find out what it's really like. And I suppose my immediate response is simply asking, just out of curiosity, how long are you wanting me to wait? Because it's already been 84 months. So I had in my notes that you guys were actually supposed to laugh there, so. So I think society, consciously or not, views relationships with God as something like a phase, or to better associate it, like a fashion trend. Maybe something that starts out strong, but fizzles out over time, once the novelty wears off, of course. It might be something that you occasionally come back to, but not necessarily something that you consistently make a priority. And, you know, it's like, you know, God, when I need you, I'll pull you off the shelf, we'll have a chat, then I'll put you back, and, you know, yeah, we'll give it some time. Maybe when my life starts falling apart again, we'll have another heart-to-heart. And that's not how relationships are intended to be, I don't think. Any relationship, be it with God or with our significant other, in my opinion, requires a tremendous amount of time and a deliberate decision to want to work at it. I am most certainly not under the illusion that it's always going to be picture perfect with Melanie and I, that it's always going to be butterflies and ice cream sandwiches. But I also know that with God's help and guidance, she's the one for me and I for her. We are the ones, we have each deliberately chosen to spend our lives together with God at the helm. In Genesis 2:24, it says, "Therefore, a man shall leave his father and mother and be joined to his wife, and they shall become one flesh." I learned that in college. I really, really love my parents, and I am incredibly fond of my future parents. I honestly cannot think of better examples for Melanie and I of what it takes to achieve greatness as it pertains to a God-centered, ever-evolving relationship. We have phenomenal role models. But I can safely say that we are very, very excited to be able to leave them, so to speak, and officially be joined together to continue building on the committed relationship that we've chosen to pursue and let God be at the center of.
Whatever your framework is, you put God in some kind of frame in your life. And these stories are just echoes of our stories because kids get it from us. Johnny's still my kid in a sense. I taught him, and did I ever teach you? No, I didn't. I left. You got there too late. There's other kids. We work with them, and just like you work, and it's engagement, and the image of God comes into play as you go after it. Be willing to open your heart and put him in that frame and see what happens. God's big. Too big for any of these frames, but not too big to fill our lives. Let's pray. Dear Jesus, here we are, and just ask that you would come and be a part of us, engage us, draw us in. The framework of our lives.